4 myths that you need to know about the Abortion Act passed in New York, plus Blackish, Thank You Next, and a lot more. My name is Elisa Steele. Welcome to Deconstructing the Culture. Now, in case you didn't already know, recently the big news that's everywhere and is upsetting Christians and pro-lifers all across the United States is that New York decided to legalize abortion essentially up until birth. And there are some big problems with that, which we can see right off the bat. Of course, abortion is evil, and anything that extends abortion or makes it more accessible is very evil. But I think that there might be a silver lining to that. Before we get to that, we're going to go over 4 myths of what basically the common myths and also the misunderstandings around the New York abortion law. This is an article brought to you by Nancy Flanders over at Live Action. Live Action is one of my very favorite pro-life organizations, so for sure check them out. So it starts, New York's changes to the abortion law that has been in place for the last 49 years has caused confusion among both pro-lifers and pro-choicers. From what health of the mother encompasses to whether women will die without late-term abortions, the myths and false assumptions are everywhere. So here are the facts. Myth number 1, the New York law only allows for late-term abortions when the health of the mother is at risk or in the most dire of circumstances. I've heard this a lot, especially on Instagram. Truth. In 1973, on the same day that Roe v. Wade was legalized, the Supreme Court released its ruling on another abortion case called Doe v. Bolton. In this decision, the court found that physicians, as the medical experts, should be the ones to determine if an abortion is necessary or not. Doe's text reads, "Medical judgment may be exercised in the light of all factors, physical, emotional, psychological, familial, like family issues, and the woman's age, relevant to the well-being of the patient. All these factors may be related to the health of the mother. Therefore, when the New York law or any abortion law uses the phrase in the risk of the mother's health, the definition of health can be any reason under the sun, left up to the discretion of the abortionist who stands to profit financially from the abortion." So essentially, just to break that down a step further, if an abortionist is working at a Planned Parenthood, let's say, they make money. Their bottom line is affected by whether or not they have an abortion. So if it's completely up to the abortionist and the person providing whether or not that girl's health is at risk, whether it's her family doesn't want her to have a child, or she's just so young, she wants to finish school, or her mental health be affected, she'll be sad if she has to carry the baby. That abortion provider can make the decision that it's in the woman's best health to get rid of that baby. Myth number 2, women will die without late-term abortions. Truth, purposefully taking the life of a preborn child is never, listen to me, never necessary to save the life of the mother. For example, with preeclampsia, in which a woman's blood pressure becomes dangerously high, a woman's life can be put in immediate danger. Would it be better for a physician to perform an emergency C-section to save the mother and help save the hope they can save the child, or commit a late-term abortion that will take at least 2 days, after which the woman will go through labor to deliver the dead baby? Wait, did you catch that? She has to deliver the dead baby anyways. So even in the case where it dangerously raises the mother's blood pressure, if you do a late term abortion, you have to kill the baby and then she has to deliver it anyways. So she was gonna deliver it anyways. Why not deliver a live baby? And you know what's even better, maybe even safer for the mom all around, and definitely safer for the baby, is do an emergency C-section. That will be much more effective and much safer. In that case, it is definitely not needed to do a late-term abortion to save the mother. Also, you should know that children born as early as 21 weeks are now surviving and thriving when given proper medical attention. That's so early. Not even, maybe 10 years ago, we didn't even know that they could survive as early as 21 weeks, okay? So this is amazing. We have amazing technology that allows us to save mother and child and put them in the best possible position for the best health. In fact, since this explosive New York abortion law was signed, doctors have actually been coming forth with the truth. So this is not just something that pro-lifers are saying. This is true, hard facts that even doctors are backing up. So Dr. Omar L. Hamden tweeted, "I want to clear something up so that there is absolutely no doubt. I'm a board-certified OBGYN who has delivered over 2,500 babies. There's not a single fetal or maternal condition that requires third trimester abortion. Not one. Delivery, yes. Abortion, no." Dr. David McKnight wrote, "It appears that the state of New York has legislated that an unborn baby can now be killed at term. As a board-certified practicing OBGYN physician for over 30 years, I need to say publicly and unequivocally that there is never a medical reason to kill a baby at term. When complications of pregnancy endanger a mother's life, we sometimes must deliver the baby a little early, but it is always with the intent of doing whatever we can to do it safely for the baby too. God help us." These are just two guys, two of the many doctors who are speaking out. Myth number three, late-term abortions are necessary in the case of fetal anomalies. As Dr. Hamadad stated in his tweet that I just read, there isn't a single fetal condition that requires abortion. It is devastating when parents receive a perennial diagnosis for their preborn child, but killing a child is not medically necessary. Still, in about 67% of children diagnosed with Down syndrome, guys, 67% of children who are diagnosed with Down syndrome are aborted in the United States. That is so devastating. And I've read numbers where in other countries, it's like in the 90s, it's much higher. But still, any number of aborting a baby just because they're Down syndrome is horrifying. Now, they're aborted in the United States at the rate of 67%, which is a complete act of discrimination based on misinformation about life with Down syndrome. In cases where doctors label the child as incompatible with life, such as trisomy 18, advancements in medicine and the willingness of doctors to help these children are proving that children can survive trisomy 18. However, for children with conditions that will more than likely cause their death shortly after birth, abortion is not necessary. The abortion industry claims that a woman will avoid weeks of sadness from carrying a baby she know would die. However, research indicates the opposite. Studies show that women who terminate because of perennial diagnosis suffer from depression and regret, including guilt from the abortion, social isolation because of the abortion, and grief triggered by reminders of the pregnancy. Women who carry to term, on the other hand, report feeling emotionally and mentally prepared for their child's death, having a sense of gratitude and peace surrounding the brief life of their child. I also personally, on a personal level for this, I have a stepbrother. So my stepdad, whom I call my real dad, you guys know about this if you follow me on Instagram, my stepdad has a son and he's probably, I think he's 4 or 5 years older than me. And so he's my stepbrother. He was diagnosed with spina bifida, I believe, before he was born. So he was born and the doctor said, you know, he probably won't live very long. He definitely won't be able to walk. Well, guess what? None of that's true. He's now 20 something. I don't remember exactly how much older than he is than I am. He's in his 20s. He's successfully doing his dream job in New York, and he walks, and he has to have a lot of surgeries so that he could walk properly, but he's living, he's thriving, and you know what? Left to abortionists and with a different set of parents, he might have been aborted, and we would never know the beautiful life that he, and sunshine that he is, and the gift that he is here on earth. And so, I don't believe in this. I don't believe in this idea that just because a child might live a difficult life or might have to have a lot of surgeries or might even just have to live a short life, that somehow that makes their life less valuable. It doesn't. It is just as valuable as your life or my life. And a child with Down syndrome, they're still a blessing to their family. Talk to just about any family who has a Down syndrome child and they will tell you that they love their son or daughter with all their heart and that they're a blessing to their family and they cannot imagine life without them. It's just sick that people would use that honestly as an excuse to get rid of the child because they're not perfect in that parent's eyes. They are perfect in God's eyes. And they're perfect in their own way, and their life is valuable no matter what. Now, the last myth number four. No one has late-term abortions, or else they're very, very rare. Truth. According to the latest data, there are about 1,671 abortion providers in the United States. Of those, 20% commit abortions after 20 weeks. That equates to more than 330 abortion providers nationwide who are willing to kill viable preborn children. According to the Center for Disease Control, in 2015, approximately 8,296 abortions were performed at and after 21 weeks of gestation. That is horrifying. That is about 25 preborn babies, 21 weeks or older, killed per late-term abortionist. Late-term abortion is definitely not rare. That's 25 people who were killed after they could have survived out of the womb. That's 25 people. One of them could have cured cancer. One of them could have created a way to live on the moon. We don't know. But what we do know is it doesn't matter what they would have or wouldn't have achieved on this earth. That's 25 innocent human beings who could have survived and had a life of their own, and we killed them because they were an inconvenience to their parents. Just sick. Now, moving on. Now, we might ask ourselves, why does abortion seem to be getting so prevalent? Why is it that we're talking about it so much? Why is there so many people who are blatantly, not just rare, safe, and legal, but now it's shout your abortion? Why do we have why is there such a thing as a hashtag shout your abortion? Why does this exist? Well, my theory is that we have increasingly come into a society and developed a culture where we look at children as burdens rather than blessings. Now, are children burdens? Yes, to some degree. They are a heavy responsibility, but they're also the greatest blessing that will ever happen to you. And they're also the most important mission you can ever have on this earth is to raise children. And whether they're biologically your own, or whether you adopted them, or you're like Mother Teresa pouring into and loving on other people's children, children are a blessing to this world. But we have a culture who thinks, or that thinks, otherwise. So this is an article that was posted on CNBC, and the title of the article was, "Here's how much you save when you don't have kids." Does that sound like a pro-kid culture? Nah, not really. So CNBC wants you to know that kids make you poor. This is an adaptation from the Daily Wire. "It's almost like some people see children as nothing but a burden. In an article from CNBC updated on Thursday, author Yanni Bloomberg writes that kids are really just the worst. Your friends may tell you that having kids will make you happier. They're probably lying. Research shows that parenting leads to a happiness gap. Maybe that's because the pleasures of parenthood are outweighed by the extra responsibilities, housework, and of course, the cost." So you're telling me right here, Bloomberg, that parents would rather that they weren't parents because of housework and money. Okay, well, are you actually a parent, Bloomberg? I do wonder. And if you are, maybe you shouldn't be. And if you're not, maybe you shouldn't ever be. They continue here. He goes on to suggest that these costs may be keeping people from having kids, since Americans are indeed having fewer kids these days. Maybe that's due to people like Bloomberg and the pro-choice activists constantly telling people that children are just the worst. A child born in 2015 is expected to cost an average middle-income married couple between $12,350 and $13,900, as the U.S. Department of Agriculture notes in the 2017 report. Bloomberg then goes on to note how expensive children are in their first year. Babies in particular are expensive. One parent who tracked every dollar found that she spent over $20,000 in the first 18 months alone. And that's on the low end. Households bringing in $200,000 can spend $52,000 in just the first 12 months of a newborn's life, according to a report from NerdWallet. Pregnancy and delivery are pricey too. Even with insurance, giving birth to a child could cost you around $3,400 out of pocket. And then there's college. Public universities cost tens of thousands of dollars a year, so if you plan to support your child through higher education, your total cost of raising a couple of children falls around $730,000, according to Bloomberg's calculations. Ugh, who wants to throw away that kind of cash? Maybe the people who don't see children purely as in financial terms and recognize not only the social benefits of furthering the species, but also the personal benefits, like the unconditional love of a child. Because children are more than just about money, but the only benefit Bloomberg sees is that Oh, as Bloomberg seems to see, is their ability to take care of you when you're older. Seriously, he says at the very end, if you don't have kids, in short, you'll save a lot of money. Then again, you might lose it all to a nursing home when there's no one around to take care of you. This is disgusting. And then we wonder why we have shout your abortion hashtags. It's because we are currently allowing a culture of burden and distaste towards children. And I think that it's our job to reverse that. I think it's our job to speak up about children and the wonderful blessing that they are. You know, if you've been following me for a while, you know I don't have kids yet, but someday I do hope to have kids, and preferably more than a few. I don't know, we'll see what God's plan is, but I love kids. My husband loves kids. There's a reason why we work in industries where we get to spend, well, he works in an industry where he gets to minister to children. I personally just really love kids, and we have a lot of friends whom I get to spend time with their kids, and I love my younger siblings, but that's off on a tangent. Moving on. The reason why I brought you here today. The New York abortion law changes everything. Now, we've talked about the myths. We've talked about how there's a lot we need to see through with it, and there's a lot of arguments as to why it's not so bad. It is so bad. It's awful. It's infanticide. It's killing children. Okay? Now, the New York abortion law changes everything for leftists. And let's just put something out there in the open. We all have known, and we all currently know, that abortion is murder. It kills and takes a life. And Democrats know this, and Republicans know this, and conservatives know this, leftists know this. We know this, that abortion takes a life. But the difference between the conservatives and the leftists is that conservatives have been, hey, it's a life, we need to protect it. And the leftists have been like, let's change the language. Let's not say kill a baby. Let's say abort a pregnancy. You see how they soften that? And how about their most common, it's just a clump of cells. Well then, we conservatives came along and said, hey, here's science. You can't be spouting this anti-science crap about it being a bunch of cells. It has its own DNA from conception. So we conservatives are here saying to the public, hey, we need to know that there's a good and bad morality choice you have to make when you're having an abortion. And also, let's give you the facts, it is a human being. Well, here's the thing. With this new abortion act, leftists can no longer use that. It's a clump of cells. They have now openly celebrated being able to kill a full-term baby. Openly. No regret. No softening it. No saying, oh, it's still a clump of cells. No, we all know it's a baby. It's a baby before it came out of the womb. It's a baby after it came out of the womb. There's nothing magical about a woman's vagina that bestows personhood upon that baby when it comes out. Okay? There's nothing magical even about air. Maybe you had a C-section. There's nothing magical about air in the moment you breathe air. Oh my goodness, I'm a person now. I have human rights. No, you're a baby before you're born and you're a baby after. And now leftists are openly celebrating killing babies. Now, they can no longer say it's just a clump of cells, because even leftists and even Democrats know that it's not just a clump of cells, especially in 9 months. There is no way you can get around that because it looks and acts and is a baby. Okay? So leftists have pulled out the rug from under themselves. They have come forward with their true agenda, and that is to kill human life. Because we all know that they care more about the planet and animals than they care about humans. But they have made it very clear they don't care about human life. Now, the silver lining on all of this is now, even though this is so horrible and this is an atrocity and I'm devastated that this is happening and we're gonna lose babies, and not just lose babies, but they're gonna be in more pain. All their nerve endings will have developed at 9 months old and 8 months old and so forth. And I even know I am devastated, and I am gonna work my darndest, and I am gonna fight to get this overturned and speak out about this and the atrocity that it is. The left has displayed their cards. They're no longer hiding behind changing language. They have displayed their cards, which is we are anti-baby. We are for killing babies. We need to, as conservatives, as Christians, as people who believe in the sanctity of life, we need to use that to our advantage. We need to come to the public and say, listen, they're no longer hiding. This is their message. This is their agenda, and we need to fight it. Okay? That is our job now. Take what they have done, show it to the world. And you know what? As disgusting as all this has happened, I have now seen the most amazing thing. There are influencers on Instagram and on Facebook and all over social media who usually only talked about health. They only talked about yoga. They only talked about art. But all of a sudden, they're coming forward with enthusiasm I've never seen before all over Instagram. People who you would never, they're so apolitical. They wouldn't talk about politics. Now they're talking about it. Now they are so disturbed, so upset, so horrified at this happening that they're willing to come forward and speak about it. And they're touching lives that I would never be able to touch because people come to me and they follow my page when they're already interested in politics and they're probably already pro-life. But these accounts are sharing the pro-life message to people who might otherwise never see it from their point of view, from the pro-life point of view. So this is, in all tragedy, there is something good you can find. And I think this is the good. And I think we need to use it. We need to come forward with the true message that the leftists have been pushing and share it and be unapologetic and be bold. And we need to continue forward and use this momentum and make abortion illegal. And also, one more thing that if you were watching my stories on Instagram, you'll have already heard me talk about this briefly, but I just want to make the quick point that if you're going to be allowing and openly celebrating death right at 9 months when it's a viable human being, if you're openly celebrating that, then what's the difference between killing the baby right before it comes out and right after? What if you accidentally gave birth before your abortion appointment because you left it till the very last minute? What if your baby's born and you don't want it? You wanted it aborted. Why wouldn't you just kill it then? What's to stop someone from just killing the baby right after it's born, the moment it comes out? Nothing. There's nothing different. And you know what? If you're okay with killing a baby while it's still in the womb because you feel like you're going to be an unfit mother or it's not good for your emotional health or you're not ready for a baby, then what's to stop you from making all those decisions when that child is 2 years old and they're tearing your house apart and you're just tired of being a mom and you realize it's not good for your mental health or whatever? What's to stop you from taking that child's life when they're 2 years old? They're still fully dependent on you. They still can't survive without you taking care of them. All the my body, my choice arguments that you hear. So what's to stop someone from killing the baby at 2 years old or 5 years old? What's to stop them? I mean, they're still dependent on you when they're teenagers and maybe they got really obnoxious and they're really bad for your mental health. I'm just saying, follow that line of logic. Follow any line of logics that leftists put out there for abortion. And if you follow it long enough, you're going to see the flaws because really we're all clumps of cells. We're all just clumps of cells who depend on other people to stay alive to some degree or another. And if you devalue human life at any stage, you're devaluing human life at every stage. All right, we're gonna move on really quickly to the movie Blackish. It's actually not a movie, it's a TV show. I was browsing around ABC the other day, which was a mistake. All their movies are trash. And I decided to watch part of Blackish. Actually, I didn't. I was watching something else. I was watching The Goldbergs, which I think is kind of funny. And then the episode ended and it took me to Blackish. That's actually how I was watching it. But I was horrified. I actually watched it just so I could deconstruct it because I was so horrified at the whole thing. It's so freaking racist. I'm gonna play you a little clip. Here's a little clip.
You're mad at me for calling the cops.
Look, you know, I should have made it clear to you that we're not just homeowners. We're black homeowners, and because we're black, we have to look at things through kind of a dual lens. You know, we need to think about every situation and how it should go normally, and how it could go, because we're black.
Like being asked to sit on the curb while they checked your ID. They didn't ask any of the white people to do that.
Mm-mm. Yeah, it's different for us, baby boy. It's like those two brothers that were handcuffed for a while waiting for a meeting at Starbucks. Or that Ivy League student who was harassed for napping in a common area.
Those were all somebody's kids.
Just like you.
And it makes me sick to think that someone would call the police on you just because they thought you didn't belong there because of the color of your skin.
Mm-hmm.
And it scares me to think of what could happen.
See, calling the police on black people ain't nothing to play with.
Yeah, I get it now. But can I still call the cops on white people?
Can't say yes, but I won't say no.
Wow. Just wow. So essentially, this is racism towards white people because you can't leave, you can't call the police on black people because they're black and it could go wrong, but you can call them on white people all day. And that was really the premise of the show, was that there's a neighbor next door to this black family, and the neighbor has an Airbnb, and there's a bunch of obnoxious people who are, you know, loud music, you know, dumping things where they shouldn't, not taking care of their trash. And he keeps calling the cops on them over and over and over, keeps showing him calling the cops on these people. But then the minute it's a black family with their music too loud over at this house and it's inappropriate music, he won't call the cops because they're black. And then what happens is the son, who's probably like 10 maybe, he calls the cops because he's seen his dad over and over call the cops on obnoxious people. And the son, as rightfully should be, is colorblind. He just knows that they're obnoxious people, so he calls the cops because that's what you do with these obnoxious neighbors, apparently. But his dad has to teach him the racist view, which is, oh no, son, we don't call the cops if they're black, only if they're white. Oh my gosh, give me a break. And you're complaining about racism? You're teaching racism through this TV show. It's disgusting. I cannot believe that this is in modern America. Oh my gosh. Anyways, needless to say, I don't recommend watching that Blackish TV show from ABC. It's really just, it's not only dumb, and it's really, there's nothing like insightful to be gained from it. And there's nothing wrong with watching those occasionally. That's why I watch The Office, because it's dumb and it makes you laugh. This show doesn't, it's not clever. And quite frankly, it's just very, very, very racist. And if we ever made a show called Whitish and it was about white people, and then we can call the cops on black people all day long, but don't call them on white people because we stand by our white brothers. Like, no. That would be racist, and rightfully so. That would be racist. Well, it's just as racist when you do it on this show. All right, moving on to our next subject, we're going to talk about music. Thank You Next by Ariana Grande. I'm gonna play you a very brief little clip on that. Thought I'd end up with Sean, but it wasn't a match. Wrote some songs about Ricky, now I listen and laugh. Even almost got married. I'm so thankful. Wish I could say thank you to Malcolm, 'cause he was an angel. One taught me love, one taught me patience, and one taught me pain. Now I'm so amazing. All right, so outside of the obvious fact that this looks like a really slutty song and she's just kind of, you know, the usual gyrating for no reason, let's go over a couple of these lyrics. So she starts out, thought I'd end up with Sean, but he wasn't a match. Wrote some songs about Ricky, but now I listen and laugh. Even almost got married. And for Pete, I'm thankful. Wish I could say thank you to Malcolm, because he was an angel. One taught me love, one taught me patience, one taught me pain. Now I'm so amazing. I've loved and I've lost, but that's not what I see. So look what I got. Look at what you taught me. And for that, I say thank you next. Thank you next. I'm so bleeping grateful for my ex. Thank you next. Thank you next. I'm so bleeping. Spend more time with my friends. Okay, let's pause real quick before I keep reading that. So here's the problem with this. Yeah, she's being ungrateful to her exes. Whatever. What I see that's wrong with this song is the idea that it's okay and that it's healthy to serial date just for the heck of it, so that I can keep dating people and learning from all of them. Oh, that's what she's telling you. I'm learning from all of them. So thank you. Next. No, I'm sorry, but you're obviously, it just kind of sounds like you're not going into this to get married, because you say, I almost got married. Thank goodness I didn't. You're going in this to learn from them. That's kind of the general message I'm getting from this song. And that really shouldn't be the case. Sure, maybe you learned, patience and love and all that. But guess what? You can learn that in marriage. You can just date someone for marriage, get married, and you can learn all those things from one person. Because you as an individual do need to grow. You do need to learn new things. But you can learn that in a healthy, safer environment without STDs. Get married to one person, then learn all those things. Become a more patient, loving person. That's great. But the idea that it's healthy to serial date people so you can learn stuff, bad message. Wouldn't recommend it. The language obviously is unnecessary. Then she continues on. She spends more time with her friends. She's not worried about nothing. Plus, I met someone else. We're having better discussions. But I know they say I move on too fast. Yeah, you do. But this one going last because her name is Ari and I'm so good with that. So basically she's dating herself and she likes conversations with herself. That's what I'm getting from this. She taught me love. She taught me patience. That's how she handles pain. Oh, how she handles pain. That's bleep amazing. Yeah, she's amazing. I've loved and I've lost. It's not what you see. Yada, yada, yada. Basically she's saying all I need is me and my friends and mostly myself. Okay, well, good luck with that. You're gonna be sad and lonely without kids. But oh wait, if you subscribe to leftist culture, kids are just gonna be a lot of money. You shouldn't have them because you'll save money. Ugh, anyways, moving on. That's just trashy song. For books, I wanna recommend, it's a book called The Red Scarf Girl, a memoir of the Cultural Revolution. And I'm gonna slaughter this, but the author's name is Jill Lai Jiang, J-I-L-L-I, and then last name J-I-A-N-G. I'm not really great at pronouncing Chinese names unless I hear it first. Really phenomenal, truly phenomenal book. It's an easy read. You can probably read this in a day or two. In fact, I think I read this when I was probably 12 or 13 for the first time. And then since then I've recommended it to my aunts, to various friends. It's great for really any age and it's really, especially for kids, but honestly for anyone, to understand the Cultural Revolution in China and how it's kind of slowly seeped in through the culture and how they were able to destroy what they called the four olds. They were destroy old culture, what kept people together, and replace it with their communist doctrine. It really is just fascinating. It's kind of, it's not the same, obviously, because this is a true story, but it's kind of akin to, if I had to give you like the idea of the feel of the book, is to kind of like reading 1984 or Brave New World. Not the same, if this is a true story, but it kind of gives you a similar eerie feeling, like, wow, this is how government goes wrong. Really great book, definitely recommend it. If you have kids, I would say probably a great starting age, depending on their emotional maturity. Maybe around 12, they could potentially read this book, and then it's great for all adults. Really, like I said, a light, easy read. I shouldn't say light. It's an easy read, but it's a heavy. It's got a lot of meaning, a lot of lessons we can learn. This is just something. So we're moving on to our There Is Good in the World section. This isn't necessarily about good in the world. It's not a feel-good moment, but I love this moment, so I'm going to share it. It's Chick-fil-A on Twitter. I love them. Love me some Christian chicken. I'll go there any chance I get. Oh my goodness, I just went, let's think, Saturday night with a huge group of church friends, and it was awesome. So Chick-fil-A tweeted on their Twitter, "Per usual, we will be closed on Super Bowl Sunday, no exceptions," which is great if you know Chick-fil-A, and if you don't, you need to find a Chick-fil-A and go eat there because it's amazing. If you know Chick-fil-A, they're always closed on Sunday, and it's devastating. Like, I'm happy they are, but it's devastating every time I want to go and it's a Sunday. Well, Burger King, the official Burger King on Twitter replied, "Don't worry everyone, we'll be open per usual." And then they put like the emoji with the sunglasses. Okay. Then Chick-fil-A replies, "Awfully bold of you to assume people actually care if you're open on Sundays or not." I love that so much. Okay, so I know that doesn't probably count as a feel-good moment, but I loved it so much. And I had another feel-good moment, but we're actually out of time, so I'll share that next week. I'm gonna answer a couple of questions because I didn't last week and I feel really bad. Caitlin asks, "Hey, I'm pro-life for sure, but there's a few things I'm having trouble with in my beliefs. How should we handle women who have been raped and wish to have an abortion? And another common pro-choice argument that I have had trouble answering is, why are we so concerned with new babies and less so with all the children in the country who don't have proper care? Thank you. I just want to be informed because some questions are hard to answer." Great questions, Caitlin. Thank you so much for reaching out. Okay, let's answer the first part of that first. What do you do with a woman who has been raped and she wishes to have an abortion? This is very common. First off, I should point out that it's only like 0.2% of abortion cases are a woman who has been raped, so it's a tiny fraction. Outside of that, let's just talk about that tiny fraction. It is a difficult situation. The main thing I have to say straight up to that is two wrongs don't make a right. If a woman is raped and she has a pregnancy and result of that, it does not give her the right to take another human being's life. It just doesn't. And I know that's not an answer that people want to hear, especially when they've been in that kind of trauma, but that is the case. If you were to be raped and then as a result you decide to go off and find your neighbor's two-year-old and kill them, you'd be like, what the heck? Just because something horrible happened to you doesn't give you the right to go kill someone. The same thing happens. Yes, it is growing in her body, but it's not there forever. It's there for you know, 9 months, she can give the baby up for adoption, she can choose to keep it, whatever the case is, two wrongs don't make a right. And that is a difficult question to answer, and it's a difficult answer to give, but that is the right answer, and the right answer is not always popular. To the second part is, why are we so concerned about babies in our own country who haven't been born, but then there's countries, you know, there's babies who aren't given proper care. My question is, where does that come from? I don't know a single conservative who thinks, oh yeah, our foster care system's, it's just fine the way it is. We don't need to fix it. We don't need to, no. Like, that's just a slanderous lie that liberals throw, because there are zero people who are like, oh yeah, kids, if they're here and they're unwanted, yeah, we should just treat them like crap. No big deal. Like, we don't need to, like, try and find homes for them, loving homes for them, and educate. No, there's no one who does that. So I don't know where that lie came from. Like I said, it's just a slanderous lie, but I don't subscribe to it, and neither should you. That's it for today. I actually had more, but I will answer those next week, and we're out of time for now. But please, if you enjoyed this content, or if you follow me on Instagram and you enjoy my content there, leave a 5-star review, and, you know, the stars, which is the easy part. Come on, you can do that part for me at least. Subscribe, and then if you would like to leave a written review, that means the world to me. I read every last one of them, and honestly, it really helps with the reviews. So with that, God bless you. God bless America.